details of the latest news that George Smith, of course, had changed his story, like he did that 180 and went the other way, Kevin. So a lot of varying reports and varying opinions on Jackie Sherrill and how the whole situation has unfolded.
I think what you see there is the honor associated with the Texas A&M University, and I think that's one of the problems here. I think Coach Sherrill has a responsibility to reply, because maybe if it was a personal thing, he could withhold his reply until after the investigation. But I think the university suffers, the honor of the students suffer in the fact that he does not reply, and there's so much speculation. It's my opinion that he should reply, but his personal choice not to.
So now it's on to football. The opposing coach is David McWilliams, an assistant here after playing here. He's been involved with this program for a long time. Went to Texas Tech to run that program for a year when Fred Akers was called upon McWilliams, and here he is. It's been a long series. Back in 1894, the first time they've met, the Longhorns have a huge lead, but AM1 has dominated in recent years, and the last time it was 2013 over in College Station. Wayne Clemmons will kick it. Texas won the toss and deferred to the second half. Keith McAfee is one of the return men. Rod Harris is the other. Clemmons is a junior out of Dallas. There is 17, Rod Harris, who's the most dangerous kick returner on the A&M team. Harris, 2 yards deep. He puts his head down and goes down at the 20-yard line after a 21-yard return. Sophomore Bucky Richardson, a very good runner, is the quarterback. Freshman Robert Wilson, the fullback. Exciting sophomore Darren Lewis, the tailback. We have a flag, by the way. Senior Rod Harris had split on A&M's number one receiver with sophomore Gary Oliver at flanker. The tight end junior Brian Ross. At center is sophomore Mike Arthur. Richmond Webb at left guard with one of the nation's best, senior Jerry Fontenot on the right side. The tackles are L.B. Moon and huge sophomore Matt McCall, all 6'7", 295 of it.
Clipping, on the run back, past the distance, first down.
Penalty will be on number 28, defensive back Chris Crooms. You see it right there, pushing from behind. A&M will start inside their own 13-yard line.
So an early break for the Texas defense, which will be under pressure tonight. Give this to the first man through. It's fullback Robert Wilson. Wilson, a freshman. And here's the Texas defense. Veteran tackles Roger Fritcher and Warren Bolden. That's been an injury-destroyed position for the Longhorns. The ends are sophomores Mark Steed and Oscar Giles. Record-setting tackler Britt Hager starts at middle linebacker. Senior Lee Brockman and strong side linebacker. Junior Bobby Rhodes at the weak side. Redshirt freshman at the corners playing with injury was supposed to be Willie Mac Garza. Irish Lewis has replaced him. Mark Berry is on the other side. The safeties in that young secondary, Paul Bierman and Stanley Richard. Out to the right side and nothing doing for Robert Wilson. Wilson, a multi-talented freshman who's caught the ball and rushed it quite a bit this year. But this is primarily a running team that has amassed over 2,600 yards on the year. All but 68 yards by these Aggies have been amassed by very young players, freshmen and sophomores.
Wilson, one of them, only 5 receptions coming into this game. No surprise he didn't catch that.
They go with the deep give to Darren Lewis on 3rd and 9, and the Aggies are stuffed by the Longhorns on their first possession. Right tackle, Warren Bolden on the stop.
Warren Bolden is a player, number 90, that has not played until his senior year. He catches the block, steps back in the hole, and he's there. Now, the Aggies are an offensive team that likes to run right. They tried to counter. It did not work early against Texas.
Sean Wilson, sophomore punter, 23 for Texas. That is Samuels, the fullback. He's back there along with Eric Metcalf. It'll go to Samuels, and the Longhorns will have good field position, even though there's no return on the punt. Longhorns, offensively, quarterback, redshirt freshman Mark Murdoch, he's in. Senior Shannon Kelly is out. Durable senior Darren Norris at fullback. Game breaker Eric Metcalf, the senior at tailback. speed burner Tony Jones, a junior. Sophomore Johnny Walker, the wide receivers. Big Stephen Clark, the tight end. Four-year regular Alan Champagne at center. Sophomore Dwayne Miller, senior Omar Salih, the guards. Sophomores at tackle Charles Cephas and Stan Thomas. So Darren Norris, playing with an injury, starts consecutive game number 45. This one intended for his backfield teammate, Eric Metcalf, off of his hands. A little bit low it was delivered. For the A&M defense, freshman John Martin replaces the injured O'Neal Gilbert at nose guard. Senior Leon Cole, junior Terry Price are the ends. The story of this defense, the Blitz brothers, Roper and Wallace. Excellent seniors Adam Bob and Dana Batiste, the inside backers. Alex Norris and Mickey Washington at the corners. William Thomas, strong safety. Gary Jones is the free safety. Murdoch with lots of time to the sideline, and out of bounds is Tony Jones. Jones having a great year, but a bad week last week against Baylor. One catch for minus 1 yard. He's trying to set a single season record here at UT.
It's going to be a tough team to do it against. R.C. Slocum, the defensive coordinator for Aggies, said although they get pressure in their man-to-man, he will play some straight zone. That's what they did there. The reason, they want to find out if Murdoch, the young quarterback, can throw the ball accurately. At that time, he did not.
Alex Morris, left corner, on the defense that time. It's third and long, like it was for A&M. In the backfield, Darren Norris catching it, and Dana Batiste, one of the more outspoken Aggies over the last couple of weeks, and he was right there to meet the receiver.
Linebackers are the strength of this team. What you're going to see is Aaron Wallace, number 23, with the pressure. They'll dump it over, and then Dana Batiste from the inside making the tackle on Norris. These guys can fly.
Bobby Liljedahl, the punter. Wobbly one inside the 20. It's Rod Harris twisting and turning for a few yards there. A 37-yard kick and a 9-yard return. We are scoreless in the first 2:09 in Austin. Feeling you can get only in a Jeep. By Tempstar, the newest name in home heating and air conditioning. You can rely on the star. And by Bud Light, everything else is just a light. Memorial Stadium in Austin. Aggies with their second possession inside their own 25. Give us to Darren Lewis. What an exciting sophomore he is, with 1,352 rushing on the year. He's scored 6 touchdowns. He averages 5.5 every time he touches the football. Kevin Kiley, they have some great young running backs in College Station.
That's why they're running the option. They decided that was the way to go, and of course their season turned around as soon as they did it.
Little option. There is the pitch of the deep man, Lewis. The ball is on the ground. It's out on the near side, and the Aggies will keep it as it squirts to the 28. Britt Hager all over the ball carrier. Britt Hager, number 60.
There was some question after the Baylor game as to how many tackles Britt Hager made. They couldn't believe he made as many. There was an article in the paper about it. He's been in about 4 already. You can see him. He goes sideline to sideline as well as anyone. Number 60. It's a very important number here at Texas. Among others, Tommy Novus wore it. And they say Britt Hager may be the quickest of all that ever wore that number.
Jeff Lighting a couple of years ago. It's 3rd and 6. Option again. This is Lewis. First down. He might go. One man to stop him. And he's inside the 45. Mark Berry, the right cornerback, was the last man between him and 6 points. It's a 27-yard game.
Texas defense has been leaning to the offensive right. They're going to go the other way with the option. They get the immediate force, but here you see the beauty. They did not have enough defensive people on that side. They were short there, and Lewis, with the great speed in the open field, breaks it. Now they depend on Britt Hager to get out there. He waited just a little bit too long. He needed to get out a little bit quicker. Great linebacker, but he can't do it all. He has to get help from the secondary, probably the free and strong safeties on that play.
Rod Harris motion near side. He's in the pattern. It's out his way. He's inside the 20.
Rod Harris, number 17.
Rod Harris against Stanley Richard, the free safety, and that one goes for 29 yards, 56 yards in the last two plays.
Texas set to take away that run on first down. Stanley Richard is caught in man-to-man coverage. Now, Bucky, not a tremendous passer, but over the last three or four games, about 50%. He puts this one on the numbers to Rod Harris. Richard, no match for him. Big gain.
Nice play to give Darren Lewis a rest in the backfield. He comes back in now on first down at the 16. There's the fullback, Robert Wilson. Mark Steed at the left end. That's a position where Texas misses senior end Bobby Duncan. He's out with a torn groin muscle suffered in practice last week in a pass rush drill. They're also missing his brother Dwayne, a junior linebacker. He's got a shoulder injury, so the linebackers score miss him as well.
Well, not only is Bobby a fine player, but he's maybe their best against the option, and A&M now an option team.
Darren Lewis inside the 10 and to the corner. And A&M has the lead.
Again, they go left and they go wide. Watch Paul Bierman, the safety for Texas, take a bad angle. Number 22, see him caught inside and blocked at the corner. Nobody to slow down Lewis. Lewis questionable as to whether or not he's in the end zone. From that angle, doesn't look like it.
On for the extra point will be Scott Slater. He's perfect in 26, but that one barely snuck inside the left upright. So 3 minutes and 53 seconds into the ball game, the A&M Aggies on top by a score of 7-0, and some Aggs will be kissing their girlfriends in the stands.
Jeep Cherry.
Billy the alley. Wilson the fullback, number 32, sitting outside for A&M. Bierman gets caught inside, blocked. And as you can see, Lewis, 25, has a clear field to the goal line. Give him 3 or 4 or 5 yards, but don't give him the touchdown.
JP!
Darren Lewis with his 7th touchdown of the year. The 12th man squad is on for A&M. Lane Talbot, number 4, teeing things up. There's Bevo 13, the Texas mascot. Look quiet for him and his supporters so far.
Bevo 13.
You got it.
It's an unlucky number.
That's a lot of steers. This one will squirt to the end zone. Tony Jones on the back line, and the Longhorns will start at their own 20. The scoring drive took a little more than a minute and a half. Some big plays in there, some by the air, some on the ground. A half dozen plays to go, 70.
We indicated at the start of the show what Texas needs to do is get first downs. They were 3 and out. And that's not good enough. They have to control the ball and play field position. 7-0 isn't out of the game, but they need first down.
That graphic through 2 A&M possessions, 1 for the Longhorns. Behind freshman quarterback Mark Murdoch. Metcalf takes the lateral pass, manages to hold on, and gets maybe a yard. Alex Morris from left corner out there to meet him. Also the inside linebacker with good range, 24, Adam Bob.
Problem with going wide against Texas A&M, whether it's on the ground or those lateral passes, is they're so quick. Their linebacking core, again, the strength of the team. And if you don't attack them up the middle and hold them, they'll be sitting there and waiting to run to the sideline. And against Texas, they will just outrun them.
That was ruled a run on the lateral pass out to the right. Good thing for Texas, Metcalf held on initially. Metcalf. 3 yards or so. William Thomas out there with him, along with the right end Terry Price and the outside linebacker Aaron Wallace trying to contain the play.
Aaron Wallace, a junior, he'll be back next year. They say he'll be a number one pick. He's not just a pass rusher. And you can see the speed. Watch the A&M defense come to the sideline. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, counting Wallace. To the sideline. That was the wide side of the field. They can run.
Nothing there. Dana Batiste. his 48, meeting Mark Murdoch, a four-yard loss on third and seven. Time to throw, nothing developed downfield. It was time to eat the ball.
Youngster Stan Thomas, number 51, nice job for the Longhorns. This was a coverage sack. Murdoch did have the time. Everybody was covered, and then he was covered.
El-Jadah with a low kick to the 39. Rod Harris, 4 or 5 yards, maybe six. It'll be a 42-yard kick and a 6-yard return. Texas A&M had a tough road early. They lost to Nebraska in the kickoff classic, hammered at LSU. They were to play Bama. That one got hurricaned out, if you will. And then a big lopsided loss up at Oklahoma State. Then they turned things around, Kevin, won 5 in a row after changing the offense.
Well, I know a certain ESPN broadcaster that picked A&M to be in a contention for the national title. The Nebraska game, he will shall remain nameless. The Nebraska game, they lost 3 people to injury and went downhill from there, but this is a fine team.
Darren Lewis, straight ahead, slanting a bit to the right. Up from strong safety, Paul Bierman. And are the Longhorns young in that secondary? Bierman, 22, a sophomore. Next to him, Stanley Richard is a second-year player. And at the corners, redshirt freshman Irish Lewis, Willie Mack Garza, and Mark Berry. They are so young back there in the secondary. Right side, Percy Waddle, 81. A high school All-American in Columbus, Texas, a few years ago. That's only his third catch of the year. They're mixing things up here.
The Longhorns are determined that A&M will not run right, which is the strength of their offense. In order to do that, they're going to man a soft man coverage, and Texas A&M is taking what they give them, and that means throwing the ball on the early downs. That was wide open to Waddle, and it will be wide open until Texas commits more people to pass defense.
Richardson to Lewis. Inside the 40 of the Longhorns. Turned inside, Stanley Richard in on the stop. So Bucky Richardson, 2 out of 3 for 40 yards through the air. Mixing things up, passing on one down, optioning to Lewis on the next down.
2 big plays on the last drive, and this last play will run to the right. You can see Hager. Now he's going, shifting over, trying to play against the run. This is the way he shifted to the defensive left. They had enough people to stop it, but not before a 6 or 7 yard gain.
Reverse Harris, who wants to throw. Wobbles it down the field. Receiver Shane Garrett trying to come back for the football. Mark Berry never did see that wobbly pass.
Should never let a left-handed wide receiver throw that pass.
That's the first time they've done it this year. Rod Harris on an end-around earlier this year ran the football, but that's the first time and maybe the last that he'll fling it.
I don't think it should be lost here early that David McWilliams is a defensive coach, was the defensive coordinator at Texas prior to going to Texas Tech, and a very, very good one. He'll have the defense ready, and you'll see a lot of different things.
Option right on 3rd and 4. Defender got in the way and took the football. The A&M Aggies have it, but they're back on their side of midfield. And a late punch or something there by Oscar Giles of Texas could be costly to the Longhorns. Lee Brockman in on the big play too. Pitch. But then after the play, Oscar Giles, 95, hitting in an A&M player's helmet.
Oh, that's a tough penalty on the Longhorns. This is just an incredible play by Brockman, number 63. They say his motor runs 100 miles an hour. He takes the quarterback. He actually tipped that ball and was right in the middle of a bunch of people. Lewis gets the recovery, but Brockman almost made that recovery, and then a very unfortunate penalty.
Well, Kevin, it's a stupid penalty is what it is. Play was completely stopped. Defensive coach is talking to Giles saying, hey, this is a big game. Play it like it is.
They talk about Giles. They say he has a great attitude and tremendous ability. In that particular case, he could have used maybe a little bit more force.
So they move the chains. First down for A&M after what should have been a huge loss and a punting situation. considering the situation, worst penalties we've seen this year by a player. There's Richardson cutting upfield. Inside the 30, Lee Brockman's strong side linebacker got him down. Bucky Richardson has 9 rushing touchdowns this year, and the Aggies are 10-0 when he rushes for 60 yards or more in a ball game.
Here's Britt Hager on the other side. Now, he reads it's going to be wide, and what he's trying to do, that's damage control. He was the off linebacker on that play. What they're running is they're exchanging the outside linebacker, which was Brockman, on the other side, moving him inside the end, trying to get their linebackers more involved. But they are playing tricks in games, and they're going to get hit for a big play here if they don't watch out.
Cornelius Patterson in motion. Left side, that's who they're looking for. And as he made his cut, he lost his feet. Irish Lewis defending. So Patterson coming in as an extra skill player, as Richardson again mixing things up fairly well. He came in with some nice stats through the air on the year.
He is a, you see 47% there. Over the last 4 games, Bobby, he's over 50%. He has improved as a passer, but when you start pounding the ball like they do with that option, what you're throwing to is wide open receivers. He is not a tremendous passer, although his stats have improved.
On the 8th play of this drive, it's Darren Lewis straight ahead. Nothing much there. Bobby Rhodes, a rather obscure junior at weak side linebacker. Don't know a whole lot about him because Dwayne Duncombe has held down the fort there for so long. Little help up front from left end Mark Steed. So Dwayne Duncombe out at linebacker, Bobby Duncombe at end, Rhodes and Steed, the 2 men getting starts in their places. Richardson keeping straight ahead. He's down inside the 10. Britt Hager, as he's had to do so many times this year, tackling downfield. But the running dimension of Bucky Richardson keeps the Aggies moving.
The man that could have stopped him was number 63, Lee Brockman. Wait till you see the move. Very subtle move, but he'll freeze Brockman. Right corner of your screen, 63. Now, Brockman has a chance there. Look at that. He sent Brockman to the sideline with a little hip fake. And that's the danger of having a quarterback that can run the ball.
John Powell, Bucky Richardson. First down. Darren Lewis, slanting right side. Gets a couple. Host of horns there to meet him. Britt Hager, Roger Fritcher on the left side, 66. They have lost junior Rocky Allen, junior Ken Hackamack, senior Steve Llewellyn, and freshman Paul Moriarty, all with injuries in that Arkansas game from their core of defensive tackles.
And you need great defensive tackles in order that your middle linebacker can play well.
Norris, or rather Lewis, left side, easily in for the score. Nice timing on the pitch by Bucky Richardson, and the Aggies are all over the Longhorns. There is a flag lying at the 6-yard line. And it'll be holding on the offense.
Robert Wilson, number 32. We don't know who yet the hold was on, but watch 32 with the lead block. He just left the screen. You're going to pick him up in a minute on Bierman. He locks up on Bierman and drives him over the goal line. It's questionable whether or not the hold was on him. If it was, he may have had his hands open and on the shirt. This is exactly what Texas did not want to happen. We have not yet gone through the first quarter, 5:10 left, and you can see the disparity in plays. Fourth quarter, that's really going to hurt this defense for Texas if they're in the game.
And with time rolling, caught inside the 10. Rod Harris riding the back of Paul Bierman with a spectacular grab. Well, that won't be a first down or a score, but it gets them a lot closer with third down coming up.
Well, you wonder why Richardson's stats have improved. Here's one reason. Paul Bierman is getting a lot of attention in this game, and that's not bad defense. Tremendous play, actually. There's Richardson. Steve getting a hold of him.
option left. It was contained well. Football is fumbled, and Texas appears to have it. That's Roger Fritcher with his first fumble recovery of the year. Britt Hager made a big play. Kevin, they really contained the option, would not let him get outside. They had to cut it up the middle.
That's the first time they've stopped him running left without a penalty. And here's the guy, the man in the middle, Hager loose. Richardson tried to cut back in. Hager gets his hands on the ball. It's loose. And then Fritcher, who's maybe the only remaining defensive tackle that was in the picture at the beginning of the year, there to jump on the ball.
Here's a look at the containment out there.
They did a nice job, and they've been getting hurt on the left. Brockman was out there, 63, and Fritcher. They're playing tough at Texas.
Aggies were on the move, already having scored, but Texas has the ball. 7-0, A&M, 4:22 left.
What's the hottest gift for men this year?
The minute I saw it, it was like, this is perfect.
Driving for a second score, a fumble stopped them. We're 11 minutes into the first quarter, and Britt Hager, another big play for the Longhorns. Eric Metcalf. Oh, what a hit and a wrap-up there by William Thomas, a sophomore out of Amarillo. They've got a little bit of youth back there as well, does A&M, and Thomas doing a great job that time at strong safety. Under 4 minutes remaining, first quarter. A&M on top by a score of 7-0. The Aggies on the air with a record of 6-4. The Longhorns just the reverse. Metcalf again. Adam Bob, an inside linebacker. This guy can hit. He's got some speed. They've done some jockeying around with their linebackers lately, and Bob appeared to take a shot on the play.
You may wonder about the play selection. Remember, Texas's first goal would be to move the chains, keep their defense off the field. They don't want any quick turnovers. Move the ball up the field, hope to get a first down or two, and take up some time. Got a timeout now from A&M.
3:14 remaining, first quarter. Had a shot of Jackie Sherrill, and there he is over on that far sideline. Nobody was happier to see the opening kickoff tonight than him. Time to start a football game and get away from all the other stuff this week. Be sure and join ESPN Saturday, 11:30 a.m. Eastern, College Game Day. Tim Brando and Beano Cook preview the entire day in college football. With a bruised knee, he's also got a bit of an ankle problem that's bothering him. And obviously, the ice is on to keep any swelling down when the Aggs get the football again. It'll be third down. No first downs for the Longhorns yet. That should have been one, but Tony Jones simply had it slip through his arms. So a bit of a late season slump here for number four, who caught one pass last week, and a very catchable ball blown there would have been a first down. It'll be punting time for the third time by Texas. There's Bobby Liljedahl, and back at midfield will be Rod Harris with good field position coming. Oh, nice kick. Way back at the 35. Did he outkick his coverage? Inside the 40 of Texas, the punter had to make the tackle.
Coverage was there. Let's just give this one to Rod Harris. You can see the Texas players in the orange shirts. There's a good block at the corner. And then Harris with the speed. See that cut up field, and down he goes. And then finally the tackle. Tremendous athlete. Things that are happening to Texas cannot happen to him. Drop passes, big plays on the special teams will not help against a superior team.
Chris Osgood, who's a good thrower, replacing Richardson, who's shaken up with that knee. Osgood, a 6'1 junior from Moss Point, Mississippi. Gives it to Darren Lewis. And he might go out of bounds just short of the line.
I believe this is a trap. Let's watch the middle of the line. It is. It's a trap. See that? They come over and they trap number 67. Middle linebacker out of position, and then Lewis loose in the backfield, finally run down. That was an inside handoff by Osgood, crossing up the Texas defense. Again, they are shifting around back there, taking chances, and that one cost them.
Up and over, Robert Wilson, the fullback, with his ninth touchdown of the year. But it was a 35-yard play a moment ago by Darren Lewis, who now has run 10 times for 94 yards. That set it up. Bucky Richardson is on to hold this extra point attempt. And right through the middle from Scott Slater. 2:44 left, the Aggies now by 14.
Robert Wilson last year in high school, now running in touchdowns for Texas A&M, replacement for Gurley, who was a big key in this game. This is a power T formation. You can see all the people in the backfield. No mystery in this one. Right over McCall, the right tackle, and in.
14-0 A&M, and with that touchdown, Robert Wilson sets a new record for A&M freshmen. Tomorrow, ESPN starts your football Sunday with NFL Game Day. That, of course, is on Sunday with Chris Berman, Tom Jackson, Pete Exnell, and John Saunders as they preview the day in the NFL. At 7 p.m., they're back to recap the day on NFL Prime Time. At 8 p.m., our coverage of the NFL continues when the New York Giants head for New Orleans to take on the rambling Saints. Mike Patrick and Joe Theismann for all the action coming up on Sunday.
That's a big game, the Giants. And Saints were my pick for the Super Bowl. Giants, a lot of other people's picks, and that's two very fine football teams. That should be a heck of a game.
Tony Jones and Eric Metcalf back to receive the kick of Lane Talbot. They kicked it short. It's outside the 35-yard line. As returning it for the Longhorns was Deion Cockrell, a fullback, number 33. He backs up Darren Norris at the fullback position. And now Texas, without a first down through three possessions, will try to get something going, down by 14.
Well, they've had two drop passes. The big drop by Tony Jones on the last series led to that touchdown. They had to kick the ball away. The entire defense came in, and they got trapped. And they have really need to start catching the ball and execute.
Murdoch looking left side. Darren Norris, forget it. Up to meet him is Aaron Wallace, the outside linebacker. On the sideline, here's Chris Fowler.
All right, guys, A&M is a school of great traditions, and my favorite tradition is that when the Aggies score, all the Aggie fans get to turn and kiss their dates. Right? Ready? Let's go. I love the tradition. The other part is I don't have a date. I wonder if Bebo is free over here. Bob, at least you've got Kevin up there.
Yeah. Until I went to a wide shot, I thought he was going to get it on both ears.
So did I. Second and 15. Ooh, almost intercepted by Mickey Washington as Tony Jones was the intended receiver. You know, back in the old days when the Aggies weren't going so well, they used to let them do that on every first down. That's how few and far between came the scores. They couldn't do that now, though. There'd be no time to watch the game. It'll be third and long. Murdoch.
Murdoch has played well. He has had people open. He's hit him. He should be running about 66 or 70% on those passes. That's very unfair, that statistic.
There's Metcalf with a little circle move to a draw play, and he's out over the 40. It won't be enough for a first down. Dana Matisse dropping from inside linebacker, trying to contain the Longhorns, who still are without a first down, and will kick it for the fourth consecutive time.
And you saw Eric Metcalf limping as he came off the field. He's playing on a bad ankle. He has played on a bad ankle for the second half of the year.
Iljadal with a long kick back inside the 10. No problem for Harris. He wants to go from there. And he's up at the 25. A flag on the play. On his last punt return, Rod Harris became the career punt return leader for Texas A&M. He needed 11 yards coming in. No matter what happens on this call, which you figure will be a clip or a hold, he'll still have the record. So the Aggies will go way back halfway to the goal line. And they will start inside their own five. They'll mark it at the 5.5 now.
One of the problems with the Texas program this year, aside from injuries, has been lack of execution, drop passes. But it's interesting that it has not been the young people that have not executed in this game. The junior Tony Jones, and Murdoch has played well, and I believe it was Metcalf that dropped one pass.
Chris Osgood, again the quarterback for A&M. And Kevin, what would a long drive by the Aggies do to the Longhorns now? That defense would be devastated with three quarters to go. Gary Oliver was the motion man in his own end zone. Up for grabs, and there is Mike Jones, 82. A junior tight end, one of three they will use. That's his first catch of the year. Stanley Richard defending, so we've got one receiver who's caught his third pass of the year tonight, and Jones now getting in that pattern.
They went with two tight ends. Paul Bierman, the safety, blitzed, and they went to a pass pattern off of those two tight ends. Again, Texas is by alignment trying to take away the run, and that first down pass will be very effective.
Aaron Lewis off the right side. Left tackle Roger Fritcher to meet him there. Clock running now toward the end of the first quarter. We're down in the last 25 seconds. A&M on top by a score of 14-0. Darren Lewis a 15-yard run, and Robert Wilson a 1-yard dive for scores. Darren Lewis again out over the 30. Maybe the 33. They'll face a third down on the next play, which will take place during the second quarter. So the first 15 minutes have come and gone at Memorial Stadium in Austin. The Lone Star State is flying high, and so are the Aggies.
That's our flight.
It was too short, wasn't it?
Here in Austin, Bob Carpenter with Kevin Kiley and Chris Fowler. Chris will have some interesting features coming up for you at halftime tonight. We'll tell you about those a little later in this second quarter as we get this frame underway on 3rd and 3. Off the hands of Rod Harris, and it'll be a kicking situation for A&M. And speaking of Chris, downstairs to Mr. Fowler.
Okay, Bob. Trainers are working on the left knee of Texas A&M quarterback Bucky Richardson right now behind me here. They think he has a sprained knee. They're examining right now to find out if he can come back in the game, fellas.
How does the offense change without him? Osgood is a transfer, more of a drop-back quarterback. A better passer than Richardson, does not run the option as well.
Sean Wilson averaging 40 yards a kick. Knocking it to Metcalf at his own 23. Near side, not a whole lot there. And finally, brought down on the play by Texas A&M's number 27. That is John Cooper, a junior defensive back. 44 on the kick, 7 yards on the return. Austin storyline, so A&M dominating offensively. Darren Lewis is already up over 100. Longhorns have no first downs, and Texas without a first down. And, of course, with very few yards as a result. Little play action. Murdoch up the middle, wobbly pass, way down into the turf in front of Tony Jones.
One of the ways that you try to block great pass rushers is that you hit them, then back off. And there's Stan Thomas with Roper, who's one of the best in the country. Hit him first, drop back, see him move his feet, get in front of him, staying in front of Roper. Not an easy thing to do. Roper came in with 14 sacks on the year, did not have one in the first three games. So that's 14 over 7 games.
Murdoch gives it to Metcalf. Circling outside and pulled down from behind. How's that for pursuit? Aaron Wallace, 6'4", 225, catching the speedy Eric Metcalf and pulling him right down onto his back.
Any other team, Metcalf is around the end and down the field for a big gainer. Aaron Wallace is not only as fast as Metcalf, he might be faster. Metcalf is a big track performer. That was just an incredible defensive play.
Well, you have the numbers 2 and 3 men all time in sacks on the field. Roper for A&M, number 2, and Aaron Wallace is number 3. Murdoch looking upfield on third down and has Tony Jones inside the 45 and out of bounds. The big play that Texas finally gets that it's been looking for. It'll be good for 27 yards.
Stan Thomas is 280 pounds, number 51. They say he will be good. I'm here to tell you he is good. He hangs in with Roper, allows Murdoch to get to the outside. Watch the catch and the move at the same time by Tony Jones. He's only 5'7". As he catches it, a little limp leg there. Gets the defensive back and makes up for that drop pass earlier. He's a big play guy. He can run 140 pounds, should he be out there.
Tony Jones made a great move on a little stutter step away from Alex Morris. Stan Thomas at right tackle, infringing on A&M territory.
Of course, as soon as we talk about him, we put the curse of the cat people on the guy, and he...
Dead ball, false start, offense, first down.
He started against A&M, Thomas did last year, formerly a backup to Brian Nelson on that right side. But right now, as a sophomore, the Longhorns believe Thomas is the best they have over on that side. He's playing with a bit of a bum shoulder. So the Longhorn band and fans trying to generate something here in the second quarter. Leon Cole pressuring Mark Murdoch.
Boy, that was a big league play by the youngster Murdoch. Throwing
Here's
it away.
Chris Fowler down on the sideline.
Okay, injury report for Texas guys. Lee Brockman, the senior linebacker, has been taken to the Texas dressing room. He's injured his shoulder, and trainers are trying to figure out how serious the injury is. They'll know at halftime whether or not he can return. Remember, Brockman's the linebacker we heard from in the open. He desperately wants to beat Texas A&M. This would obviously be a disappointing way for him to conclude his career.
And if that puts Boone Powell in there on the strong side, you'll have linebackers starting that were nowhere near the top on the depth chart this year. Murdoch downfield. Mickey Washington had a better chance to catch the football than did 32 Kevin Nelson.
Kevin Nelson did not read he did not make the read. Now Murdoch made that read. You can see he's disappointed. It was a full blitz. Nelson was supposed to run a quick post, a hot receiver route. He never came inside. Murdoch threw the ball to the right place, and that's not going to show up in the stats for this kid. The quarterback's playing pretty well.
The stats would not, of course, reflect that. He's 3 for 11 now for 19 yards. They'll screen it on 3rd and 15. They're trying to get Metcalf outside. He gets there, but pursuit from behind. Leon Cole, 74. Great pursuit, straight back down the field from the left end. And the Longhorns fail to move the chains.
Excellent execution, though. I cannot believe that they would punt this ball.
Well, the punter, Lil Jadal, has not come on so far. Number 14 is still on the near sideline.
Clemens.
Looks like they'll try a 52-yard field goal from Wayne Clemens. His longest on the year, 55 against BYU.
The wind, Bobby, is quartering left to right, a little bit in his face on this one.
It is blocked by the Aggies. With the football is John Roper. Into the end zone is John Roper. Aaron Wallace blocked it. Roper took it in. It'll go for 58 yards, and it's 20-0.
Those, I believe, are the Blitz brothers, number 23. on the inside. You have to close the inside man when you play that. Now, they blocked this thing on the dead run. Wallace never even left his feet. And Roper down the field.
He got him. Room service bounce for 6 points.
You always leave the outside man. You don't ever let the inside man in.
No problem on the point after by Scott Slater. And now, with only 2 minutes and 16 seconds elapsed in the second quarter, Wolfitt takes it in for a 21-0 lead.
She's a driver.
All right, come on, sir.
I'm going to get a chest tube set up. He's really not living
here.
We might have to intubate him. Good night, Steve.
Might be some fractured ribs. I looked at his KUB, and I didn't see a solo shot.
This is where she was hit, and I think there's air here in the mediastinum.
Dr. Harry Selker has worked in emergency rooms and hospitals for 12 years.
Bye-bye.
Maybe that's why for 12 years he's driven Volvos. Xerox presents the Great American Torture Test, Alaska.
Xerox.
Death Valley.
Xerox.
City traffic.
Xerox.
Coast to coast to prove under the most extreme conditions you can't buy a better antifreeze coolant than Xerox. No matter where you drive.
I was a school wuss. I played golf.
Basketball, ooh. Basketball.
By Interstate Batteries and their 155,000 authorized Interstate dealers all across America. And by the U.S. Army, learn how to get an edge on life. Be all you can be. Aggies are fulfilling that role right now. John Roper has done that for the second time. He won't be around next year, but Mr. Wallace, just a junior, will. So teams will be running to Roper's side a year from now.
Well, they lose all four of their inside backers, their first-teamers and their backups, and one of their outside backers. Wallace is the only guy who will be back.
This one will go into the end zone. Tony Jones lets it fly. So Roper, who earlier in his career had a block for a touchdown against Louisiana Tech, does it in this big rivalry against the arch-rival Longhorns tonight. What a great career out of Houston. He was the 1987 Southwest Conference Defensive Player of the Year and an All-American. Looks like a high first to second round NFL draft choice. And his sack production is ahead of last year when he was awesome then, too.
I'll give you an interesting stat. Roper going in tonight had 4 fumbles caused. Wallace had 4 fumbles recovered.
What a coincidence,
yeah.
Huh?
That's a vaudeville act.
Those two can't be related in any way. Eric Metcalf. Contained pretty well so far. Dancing his way up the middle for a couple of yards. And our student of the game is brought to you by the U.S. Army. You can get an edge on life and be all you can be. Tonight's recipient, Texas linebacker Lee Brockman. Lee, a marketing major with a 3.4 grade point average and a 1988 National Football Foundation Hall of Fame scholar athlete. He's also injured right now, and with that shoulder aggravated, hopefully we'll see Lee again here tonight. Murdoch to the near side for Kevin Nelson. Alex Morris from left corner with tight coverage. It'll move the football up near first down territory. But the Horns will have a bit of a ways to go. They have to get to the 30, so they'll face third and what we'll call a short 3 yards.
There is no such thing as a short 3 yards. Murdoch, you're looking at him. They feel that he could be a very, very good quarterback, but with Metcalf leaving, they need to recruit a fast running back to go with him and some receivers. They feel he has talent.
Metcalf on third down. He has got the first down. Had to get over the 30. Made it by about a half yard where the official spots it. And Eric Metcalf, part of a Texas team that is really not a running power team at all. He came in with 880 yards. If he can reach 1,000 somehow tonight, he still has a bunch to go. He could join Earl Campbell, Roosevelt Leakes, and Chris Gilbert as Longhorns who have twice rushed for 1,000, but that will be awfully difficult tonight. Murdoch with time gets it to Metcalf. who catches his 40th pass of the year. Eric came in the leading receiver in terms of numbers of receptions, and of course in every category, the leading rusher.
David McWilliams had a lot of good things to say about Metcalf. Said as a senior with a pro career ahead of him and an injury to his ankle that he's been playing with all year, he could have sat down and no one would have said anything, but he didn't. He chose to play in some games that didn't mean a whole lot. The University of Texas in the standings is a tough kid and devoted to the program.
3-yard gain. Metcalf with a deep give from the quarterback, and he improvises for good yardage out to near the 40. They have to get about 2 feet over the 40 for another first down. John Roper, yeah, and Lafayette Turner, a reserve safety on the tackle.
Albert Jones, number 95 for Texas A&M, going up against Champaign, one of the better, maybe the best linemen for Texas. He manages to close that hole, but Metcalf long gone. And that's what Metcalf can do for you if you have some problems on the offensive line, as Texas does. In terms of ability and maturity, he's a guy who can find holes. You don't have to make them for him.
Donovan Forbes is the Texas quarterback on third and one. He's considered the number three man behind Murdoch and Shannon Kelly. Forbes, a junior out of Baytown, Texas. And things falling apart on the snap.
Dead ball, false start, offense, third down.
Ooh, that one backfired. They put Forbes in there for his running ability. Murdoch is not real mobile, and then he dropped the snap because he hadn't been warmed up.
So Murdoch, number five, checks back in. Play action to Metcalf under pressure. Murdoch unloads it, and on the near side, a catch for a first down from the tight end Stephen Clark. They've got some height on this team, Kevin, in the receiving corps. Clark goes 6'5".
Roper has a touchdown, but it's not courtesy of Stan Thomas. Thomas is giving him fits. Look, that's a tremendous move by Roper. Thomas never lost him. And that's what gave you see the pressure from the backside, but they're not getting pressure from Roper. Nice catch. First down, Texas.
Clark goes 6'5". The Cash twins, Kerry and Keith, both go 6'4". They get down deep. Passing can be their best short yardage offense. Here's Metcalf. Couple of yards to the 45. Albert Jones, who spells Leon Cole at left end, and the right outside linebacker, Aaron Wallace. One of those two Blitz brothers. On a gorgeous night in Austin, in on the stop. We still have 10:25 before halftime. Hook'em Horns, folks, need something to cheer about here. They're down by 21. Nothing from Eric Metcalf. Leon Cole, left end, 74.
Texas A&M felt that their front three, while their quality players, are not real physical. And that was the thing that prevented them from being an absolutely overpowering defense. While their linebackers could run and play well and read well, he felt their front three were not yet what they needed to be a dominating defense.
This is the ninth play of this drive, and they still haven't crossed midfield. Blind side, just missing was Jeroy Robinson, but Dana Batiste got there. Good pressure from 97 Robinson, and then Batiste finished off the play.
Good pressure from the outside. Release time for Murdoch. Obviously, he never did release the ball, but you'll see what he had. Legitimately, right there is about the best. That's not really bad, 2.5. Batiste sitting on him, coming in and dropping him.
Ojedal with a very short kick. Now it'll take a bit of a Texas hop down to the 36 or so of A&M. Longhorns contending that the Aggies touched the football and then they would get it back. But it'll be decent field position for the A&M offense, which has scored twice, so has the special teams. 21 A&M in the second quarter.
Jeffrey. And hey, thanks to the Longhorn Band for playing the ESPN college football theme here. 8:55, second quarter. Aggies with the ball at their own 36, up by three scores. Chris Osgood is still the quarterback. This is Darren Lewis. Nice containment by the Longhorns that time. Warren Bolden from right tackle, who, as Kevin mentioned earlier, was totally out of the picture until the start of this season with all those injuries. The fifth-year senior now really playing for the first time.
And playing well, they say. And they were a big surprise. They put him in there, and he did a real fine, is doing a real fine job.
His first start was against Texas Tech, and he had 16 tackles. Squirting through, fullback Robert Wilson.
There's a good story. Now, Matt Gurley, the fullback for A&M beginning of the year, was a player they felt held their offense together. Robert Wilson, a freshman, a true freshman, came in for Gurley. Over the course of three or four games, they went to the running game, and this fella has taken over. They say he would be the newcomer of the year in the Southwest Conference, except for one fellow. His name's Weatherspoon at Houston, and he's impossible to get down.
Robert Wilson, ironically, is out of Houston. Jackie Sherrill got him from Worthing High School. Let's talk a little bit about Jackie Sherrill's recruiting here, Kevin. The top-notch athletes now are going to A&M. You know, you look at some programs, and it seems like certain programs get All-Americans while the others get the All-Staters. There's a bit of a difference.
These guys come with ribbons on them.
Oh.
Every one of them. Well, Osgood is a good example. I mean, Osgood is a transfer from Mississippi with a rocket arm. He was a starter at times at the University of Mississippi. Here he is at Texas A&M. They have behind him Lance Pavlis, one of the better players in Texas out of high school. They have no problem with depth at Texas A&M. The problem is getting into the lineup.
Sherrill's quarterback, Chris Osgood, 1-for-2 through the air for 20 yards. And the Aggies of Sherrill will have a 3rd-and-3 facing them at their own 43-yard line.
I'd be looking, if I'm by you, have Osgood in the game. If Richardson was in, I'd be looking for an option. Osgood's a passer.
Rolling and throwing. Caught there and holding on, Wilson. Nice catch with the hand and then holding it against the hip to keep control. Wilson had to be on the run. He knew he had to get first down yardage, so he couldn't just totally come back just for the football, and he kept it in motion forward pretty well.
That's no accident they would throw to Wilson. He only has 5 receptions coming in, but what they did is they let him off the corner. Texas has had to replace both outside linebackers for this game. They have 2 backups in there, and that is pressure on an outside linebacker or a safety, that type of coverage.
7:42 remaining, second quarter. Darren Lewis stepping inside one man. Looked like he made a pretty nice move on Boone Powell. Powell, 56, is the one now, a redshirt freshman out of Duncanville, Texas, who has to step in and replace the injured senior Lee Brockman.
Mike Arthur made the big block, the center, number 52 for Texas A&M on this, and he went after the fellow we were just talking about, Knighty Bolden, and a little leg there, which is not legal. And Darren Lewis able to cut up inside.
7:16 remaining before halftime. The Aggies of A&M going for another one. They lead it by 3 scores.
Give your kids the competitive edge in their...
Left side for Percy Waddle. It'll move the chains for A&M as we're in the final 6:45 of the first quarter. Aggies on top, second quarter, 21-0 A&M. And now the Aggies are down inside the 35 of Texas. And we get a report from the field that Britt Hager is shaken up a bit. Slanting in from that right side behind the quarterback, fullback Robert Wilson. Oscar Giles at right defensive end, making the stop.
Britt Hager may be shaken up, Bobby, but he was in there on that play. play, and he's in the huddle right now. Last year we did this game, and Britt Hager was injured. They had to just about drag him off the field. He was injured pretty badly. Five plays later, he was back in. Said, "Coach, I'm not going to stand here. I'm going back in." He's a tough one.
Yeah, that was a pretty tough shoulder injury he was dealing with that night in College Station. Quick drop up over the top, and Rod Harris defended nicely. Mark Berry step for step with the speedy senior Rod Harris.
Berry does a great job jamming him at the line of scrimmage. You don't see that, and then gets back into coverage. And all he needs to do now to complete what would have been a perfect defensive play is catch the ball. That was a tremendous play by Mark Berry on a good senior receiver. But what Osgood was trying to do, he was audible into that play, and Berry came up and jammed him. It was supposed to be one of those lob passes over his head, and he never let him get the play. Berry did.
We show you some passing stats on third and nine. Over the middle, 81, Percy Waddle, flag on the play. More flags at the end of the play. Willie Mack Garza playing hurt tonight, did not start. 17 in your screen right there, in on the stop. And we'll have to check a couple of different calls here. One in the offensive backfield and one well downfield.
It's going to be a penalty on Harris offensively.
We have offsetting fouls. We have a face mask on the defense. We have illegal motion on the offense. The penalties will offset. We will replay the down.
Rod Harris went in motion and did something I don't think I've ever seen before. He does a little fake towards the line of scrimmage. Watch him. That's a penalty. You can't do that. You can't fake the guy before the ball snapped. You can do that in Canada. You can't do that in American college football. I've never seen a motion man do that. You can't go to motion towards the line of scrimmage in the United States.
Right down the middle, Harris inside the 10, beating Mark Berry this time. And what a great touch by Osgood on the throw.
Well, Chris Osgood started, and as I said, four games for the University of Mississippi in 1986. This is man coverage. Harris just beats Berry, and Osgood lays it out on a post pattern. Safety's not there. Again, Texas playing the run all the way, using all the available manpower to stop the run. That leaves Rod Harris, very dangerous receiver, one-on-one on those cornerbacks. It's not working for Texas.
Harris, three catches, 66 yards, first and goal.
There's another audible.
A fake to the belly of the fullback, and a touchdown for A&M. Scott Slater, 3 for 3 tonight. Now he's 30 for 30 on the year. Watch the fake into the belly of the fullback, and the quarterback runs it pretty well.
Here's Hager. He's the guy you would hope would be there. Richmond Webb pushes him off course. Fontenot, anytime you have two linemen double teaming a guy like that, he has no chance. The rest of the team has to cover up. Osgood audible on this play, and it turned out pretty well. Never thought about giving it to the fullback. Took it up inside and made it work.
5:01 left first half. The route is on. Aggies by 28.
At 16 Bedford Street, the toast is with five.
For halftime, Texas needs a big play, maybe on this return, from either Eric Metcalf or Tony Jones, as Lane Talbot kicks it away. 33 is Deion Cockrell. So the Aggies refusing to kick the ball deep into the sidelines. Here's Chris Fowler.
Bob, they say what makes this rivalry so intense is that the Aggies and the Longhorns have to share the state. Well, here we've got a Longhorn and an Aggie, Sheila and Tom Eversage, who have to share the same house. Tom, you told me it's a little bit nasty the week of the game.
Well, we usually don't talk about 2 days before the game, and after tonight, I don't think we'll be talking for about a week.
Sheila, he's done most of the talking the past few years.
Yes, he has. I'm sitting up there going, they score on us.
But you have the right to kiss your date after a score. You haven't been doing that.
No, I haven't gotten slapped yet.
Okay, thanks. Back upstairs.
Probably won't let him. Out to the left side, Tony Jones on that outside pass. And back into the game for Texas now is Mark Murdoch. He had left for that one third down play when Donovan Forbes came in and couldn't handle the snap. Came back in, they couldn't move the football. And so it's Murdoch, the redshirt freshman from Round Rock, Texas. We'll look at the scoring drive as A&M took 10 plays, almost 4 minutes worth, to go 64 yards. And Chris Osgood, their backup quarterback, dove it in. Eric Metcalf slants left side. Nice movie made around Albert Jones, but all that does is slow him down a bit so that those Blitz brothers can find him. And Aaron Wallace, 23, in on the stop. We were talking earlier about his speed, Kevin. He runs a 4.5 40. Now, a 4.5 40, that's down there in running back territory as far as times go, running backs and receivers.
Defensive backs. 4.5 is, that's good speed. That's professional speed, and it's quick, real quick.
Forbes is in at quarterback again, optioning, pitching to Metcalf. And he is short, it appears. On third down, Alex Morris cracking up from left cornerback. They needed to get to the 43 and did not.
They recognize and react so well. You tip your hand a little bit with Forbes in the game. There's your pressure immediately on the quarterback, and now they're everywhere on the corner too.
Boy, was John Roper in there quickly.
And look at Batiste. Batiste getting ready to, he got there a little late.
Bobby Lojedal now will punt for the sixth time tonight. Rod Harris awaits. Spirals, good hang time at the 12. No fair catch, and he loses a couple on the return. A flag on the play, lying very near where the tackle was made. So Harris, a rather daring punt return there. With good hang time, good coverage, he still tried to do something with it.
I think they may be calling hurdling here. I think it was number 47. For Texas.
Well, catch, interference against the kicking team. 5 yard penalty. It'll be a first down.
I think it was Sullivan. Robert Sullivan, a linebacker, number 47. I think what he did, they're going to say he's too close, but this is a really a. That's a great effort.
Wow.
That's a rough call. I give him an 8 on that one, though. That was nice. Needed to straighten his legs there at the end. He would have been in clean.
What a block there by Deion Snow of A&M. Chris Osgood, still the quarterback. Robert Wilson, that fullback out of Houston. Averaging 5 yards every time he grabs the ball. Texas starters, a lot of young folks. It's divided evenly now between upper and underclassmen.
Well, no, actually, the juniors, Bobby. You see that four juniors, there was a gap here. In Fred Akers' last years, there was a lot of negative press, and some people felt that he couldn't get the recruits that he needed because they didn't feel he was going to be here for a couple of years. So those last two classes, while they have some stars, they don't have any depth.
On the snap, a fumble, and Texas with the football. Oscar Giles in on the play, 95. And the Longhorns get a big play at the 15 of A&M.
The big O, number 95. They say Oscar could be a superstar. One of those young players, a sophomore. It's a fumbled snap. Osgood never had it. And here comes Giles closing fast. And he finds a little present laying on the ground. 185 pounds. Osgood, he dropped the ball.
Hey, our crew knew right where to put that ground level camera. Great shot, folks. And now Texas with a big chance. They've got to score before halftime. Metcalf, forget it. Lafayette Turner gambling from strong safety. They love this guy. He's not a starter. He's very quick, and he is a hitter. He's one of those great Aggies out of Carter High School in Dallas. That high school has produced Rod Harris, Darren Lewis, Turner, and former All-Southwest Conference performer Chet Brooks. What a pipeline to College Station from the Big D. Murdoch to Tony Jones. That is inside the 10. Alex Morris, left corner on the coverage.
Alex Morris, number 30, defending.
Murdoch flung that one pretty well. Quarterback coach Steve Bricky of Texas says, we've got a good feeling about this young man who came on to replace Shannon Kelly.
A&M will not let Tony Jones or Metcalf beat him. So look for the tight end. Look for someone else. Cash, one of those players.
Up over the top on third down. Oh, what a catch by Kerry Cash. We talked earlier of the height of these Texas receivers, the Cash twin brothers, and here's Kerry.
6'4", 215 pounds. And Murdoch, tremendous pass. Not only are they big, they have great leaping ability, and you can see it there.
Derek Ritchie on the coverage, and he was nowhere near the receiver on that one. Wayne Clemens, 22 for 22 on points after, and Texas gets the score.
Well, Derek Ritchie's close, but he's only 5'11", and he can't jump with Cash. And Murdoch is the key. I mean, that's a tremendous pass. If it's anywhere else, Ritchie has the coverage. He lays it in there perfectly. Big break for Texas. Here from behind Murdoch. This kid's played well. Look where this pass is. There's only one guy that can get it, and that's Cash.
And the Longhorns continue their good percentage of those tight passes for touchdowns this year. They've been down deep in enemy territory something like 8 times, and they've thrown that kind of pass for scores 6 of those times. So it's a 28-7 game with 2:05 before halftime. Here's Chris Fowler.
Okay, thanks very much, Bob. Folks, welcome to my little house on the field down here. We'll have a special Thanksgiving halftime. All kinds of stuff coming up. Halftime, it'll focus on the spirit of college football and also the spirit of this holiday. Stay with us. I think we're going to enjoy it, fellas.
It's a little house on the prairie.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
A real pioneer he is down there.
Little Joe Fowler.
We'll call him Joe Bob down here in Texas. There's Chris and his little house from behind. I think the problem is he's right next to the A&M cannon, Kevin, and that baby could come tumbling down anytime.
They ought to turn it around and shoot the thing off. I've been to his place in Connecticut. That's nicer.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot tidier, too.
Yeah, that's right.
So the Longhorns getting that score, 2:05 before halftime. The turnover results in 7. Wayne Clemens will kick it off. Keith McAfee is back. So is record-setting Rod Harris.
I'd love to see an onside kick here.
You'd like to see it recovered, wouldn't you?
Well, I'd like to see an onside kick because I'd like to go for it. Go for it. Traditional rival. We talked about pride and emotion. Let's see something.
Clemens will pop it up high. It'll be Harris at his 2.5. This guy has over 1,100 yards in his career in kickoff return yardage. An A&M record on the tackle for the Longhorns was Anthony Curl, a linebacker on special teams. So the Horns appear to be fired up. We'll see what their defense can do now.
The defense has not played all that badly. They were on the field a lot. Remember the drop pass again. I don't mean to beat on Tony Jones, but he dropped that pass. They scored right after. And then, of course, the blocked field goal for a touchdown. This game could be closer.
Chris Osgood, the quarterback, with Bucky Richardson's knees shaken up. Darren Lewis will take pressure off your quarterback when you have a guy like that to give it to. Britt Hager with an amazing number of tackles in on the stop.
Show you how smart this guy Hager is. They tried to fake him out. He never even thought about going the other way. The motion went that way, and Hager, although he gets blocked, he helped pile it up there in the middle. He never took a false step. He went immediately to the ball.
Yeah, not in on the tackle, but he simply used about two bodies of the Aggies to close the hole.
Well, he's not a real big guy. He's about 5'11". They list him at 6 foot, but he plays smaller than that because of his technique.
On second and seven, the deep pitch to Lewis eludes one tackle, gets outside, and wrapping him up was Stanley Richard, the free safety. Already tonight, Darren Lewis up over 100 yards. He came in with 1,352. He's averaging 150 a game, and that's second to only, guess who? Mr. Sanders at Oklahoma State. And if he goes for 100 again, he will join, if he did, some elite company. Earl Campbell had 10 in 1977.
I think he's over 100, isn't he?
Yeah. That's nine, though.
Well, that's nine. Okay.
Officials call a timeout here. 38 seconds on the clock. A&M 28-7. We'll see how the Aggies play it here. Will they gamble a bit? They've got a third and one, or do they just get their first down and run out the clock? Lewis has it. James Patton, a freshman, spelling Warren Bolden at right tackle. 92 in on the stop. Clock stops as the chains move. So Darren Lewis, ever busy here tonight. He will leave. That's good. Up the middle. And it is caught there by Larry Horton. Horton, a 6 foot sophomore who spells Lewis at tailback. The clock runs out and the first half ends all Aggies. 28-7, though Texas did get a late turnover and turned it into a score. So it's 28-7 for Jackie Sherrill's Aggies. And downstairs, here's Chris Fowler.
Okay, Bob, as we said, a lot going on halftime right after this break. We'll show you the Texas A&M band, one of the great bands in college football. And then a story on a football family that has a lot to be thankful for this holiday season and a portrait of a very courageous young man.
As it is in rushing and total yards. The first down started out 8-0 at one point, now 14-4 in favor of the visiting team. Now, you might go back to the game and remember that Texas won the toss and deferred, so they will have the football after this kickoff, starting the second half of play. Kickoff man for the Aggies is Scott Slater. He'll tee it up here at Memorial Stadium in Austin. We'll check that. It'll be Lane Talbot on the kickoff team. And it'll come down at the 9 to Eric Metcalf. He angles near side and fumbles the football. A&M had a real shot at it, and the Aggies did not recover. There was a big hit put on by Petty, a quarterback for A&M, seeing action on the special teams. Watch number 15 here.
Well, this is Terry Metcalf trying to make a big play, trying to turn and spin in there. And knowing they need a big play, the ball just comes loose, and Texas, fortunately for them, recovered. That would have been the knockout blow right there.
That's correct one thing. 15 was Derek Nazer, one of those 12th-man kickoff members in attendance here tonight. Second half underway. Texas almost with a disaster. Now to move the football. Murdoch stumbling and completing it to the tight end, Stephen Clark. Leon Cole pressuring the passer, but Murdoch kept his balance.
Well, Texas high school football is a lot like college football. There's a lot of pressure. He's from Round Rock, Texas, out of Westwood High School, and you're right. He's a kid who kept his eye on his receiver, and they like him here at Texas. He's not the greatest runner, real quick, not mobile, but he's been throwing pretty well tonight. His statistics aren't bad, and they would be even better if some of these balls had been caught.
They like the way Murdoch looks downfield and sees things, reads and reacts. Gives it to Metcalf outside, and he's chased down by Aaron Wallace. We'll take a look at the old possession chart here. This is the one for the Longhorns. Negative yardage and a kick. Negative yardage and a kick. Then they finally got a few but still kicked it. Again, you see no first downs until they went down and had the field goal blocked for an A&M touchdown. 9 plays in a punt, 3 in a kick, and finally, after a turnover and fumble by the Aggies, it took them 3 to get it into the end zone. The pass to Kerry Cash for the touchdown. Metcalf in motion. Lateral pass. Great coverage by the Aggies. They were not fooled at all. Alex Morris, the left cornerback, number 30, led the charge outside left.
John Roper, 225 pounds, can do a lot of things for you. You hear a lot about the sacks. But look at the reaction by John Roper. Sheds the block and causing trouble in there. Metcalf having to avoid him and then getting picked up by the rest of the defense. Make no mistake about it, this is one of the fine defenses in the country. He may be the best linebacker in the country, among the best, certainly.
Came in with 35 career sacks, did Roper. Murdoch airs it out. Too tall for 5'7", Tony Jones.
That pass, number 4, Tony Jones, incomplete.
There is Gary Jones in on the coverage. Mark Murdoch played very well late against the Razorbacks of Arkansas. He came in the second series in the third quarter with Texas down 24-0, a game they eventually lost by a count of 27-24. He's been the man ever since. He's hit 7 straight. And so we have a timeout on the field. 13:03, third quarter. A&M by 21.
GM makes the dream. GMAC makes the dream yours. Ask your GM dealer how Custom Tailored Smart Lease helps you drive home a lot of new car or truck without tying up a lot of money.
The dreams of America, GMAC.
It's the trestle of terror, ladies and gentlemen. Chevy versus Ford, going over 8-inch high landmines in a test of 4x4 ground clearance. The bullseye Chevy clears the mines front and rear. The Ford clears up front, but it's too low in back. In four-wheel drive ground clearance, Chevy beats Ford. No wonder.
Of America's Dream by Michelob. One taste will tell you why the night belongs to Michelob. And by Play-By-Play Talking Football. The best game next to the real game from Video Technology. Memorial Stadium, Austin, Texas. Happy Thanksgiving to you. Kevin Kiley, Chris Fowler, I'm Bob Carpenter. And the Longhorns facing 3rd and 11. Renfrow gets away from a couple of tackles. And finally, Roper, Gary Jones hitting him hard. It'll be a kicking situation. And how about this call by the Horns on third and 11?
Well, you have to try it, I think. And I think, you see, you have Roper at a three-point stance now. He's in. He's going to get a shot at Cockrell. He misses it, but this is what All-Americans are all about. He's not on the ground long, and he's after him.
Rod Harris back to receive the kick and retreating. And his sixth. And good coverage by the Longhorns on a great kick of 55 yards by Bobby Lodgedahl. Seven on the return. Here's Chris Fowler.
Okay, Bob and Kevin, some bad news for Texas on both sides of the ball. Darren Norris, their fullback, will not return. He has injured an ankle. And on defense, Lee Brockman, the strong side linebacker, we told you he injured his shoulder in the first half. He is not going to return, so two seniors go out on a bad note.
Norris had started every game since he had been at Texas. You may remember he was the little guy in front of Edwin Simmons. When Simmons played, Simmons was the tailback, and little Norris was the fullback, and has done a remarkable job and been a great player for Texas.
Chris Osgood, the A&M quarterback. Darren Lewis, the carrier, on the pitch. Outside and very little. We should add a footnote on those injuries, that they are both re-injuries. Darren Norris had a bad ankle coming in. Lee Brockman had a bad shoulder coming in.
Well, you talk about injuries with Texas. I've been following, I did the Southwest Conference 2 years ago. And of course, we had Texas last year. They had two tackles, Llewellyn and Hackerback, which were excellent play. I never saw either one of them play. I must have done four or five Texas games. They have been injured for 3 years. Hackamack will be back. Llewellyn is done.
As a senior, Hackamack a junior. Lewis squirting through, and he took a pretty good shot from Stanley Richard. Roger Fritcher also there. The A&M first half was a prolific one scoring-wise. They punted their first time and then went a long way, 70-plus for a score, fumbled down deep, which kept them from going up 14-0. They did then on three plays. After kicking the football, they got a touchdown on 10 plays, negative yardage on a fumble. Their other score, you remember, came on the block punt. That's how they got the 28. On third down, the Longhorns hold. Britt Hager, number 60, in the middle of things.
Hager plays hurt, but he plays. This is a very fine linebacker, and laterally may be the best in the country. Stepping inside, getting pushed. Look at the reaction. He was pushed. That's a penalty. They didn't call it, and Hager still made the tackle. Tremendous defensive play.
Sean Wilson, who gets consistent hang time, punting the football, came in averaging 40. Metcalf and Samuels waiting. He's kicked it tonight twice for 41 yards in average. That one got down in a hurry, rather low. Metcalf at his 45, smacked as he crosses midfield. 36 on the kick, 6 on the return. And with 10:23 remaining third quarter, A&M 28, Texas 7.
Looks like Winter just did in that poor fellow's battery.
Ahead of Texas 28-7. And next Thursday, the Hurricane Bowl, they've dubbed it, as the Crimson Tide of Alabama, scheduled to play in College Station September 17th, couldn't make it because of Hurricane Gilbert. Next Thursday, weather permitting, they'll be there.
Yeah.
Tim Brando will be there, and so will Lee Corso for all the action on ESPN. Just across midfield are the Longhorns. Left sideline and way too tall for Tony Jones from Mark Murdoch, Mickey Washington. Good coverage there. Number one should be a good athlete. He's got good pedigree, Kevin. He's the cousin of the great Joe Washington, who played at Oklahoma, and then, of course, on to the NFL.
That was a pretty good player. I'm very impressed with Murdoch, Bobby. He threw one away in the first half. He read the blitz, got rid of the ball right away. Now, he didn't complete the pass, but they never got near him. And has not been, he's 10 for 19 for 72 yards, but he's not been sacked, but how many times? I don't know that he's been sacked yet.
He has passed 1,000 yards on the year with his performance tonight. Metcalf nowhere to go, and then he slipped as he was running away from Adam Bob, the inside linebacker. Number 24 has had an up-and-down season, rather inconsistent, but many consider him a legitimate pro prospect.
As you look at Metcalf, now Metcalf is down. He came in with an ankle injury. This is the play. They give it to him on a draw play and really just trying to confuse the defense. Looked like his ankle just gave way. See? He never really did get going, and now he's down. He's played with that bad ankle for a few weeks.
Chris Samuels, a sophomore out of San Antonio, is who backs up Eric Metcalf, a senior. They also go sophomore in the three deep with Eric Williams.
There is no backup for this kid.
Not with all the things he can do.
I mean, this is a fine, fine football player from Arlington, Virginia. Right ankle. As he turns, and he just looked like he has no strength in it. Didn't look like it turned really badly. It just seems like it's weak.
Deion Cockrell in motion. Down the middle they go. This one is over the receiver, and Derek Ritchie intercepts, and we have a flag. Ritchie with his first INT of the year.
I would imagine this would have to be a clip, and it's going to be called. The clip was performed on Tony Jones, I think. This is a very strange play when you see this. Poor Tony, 140 pounds.
Clipping by the team that intercepted the ball after the interception. It'll be a 15-yard penalty and first and 10.
All right, now Ritchie gets it. Gary Jones is going to be the fellow that clips 140-pound Tony Jones. And watch what happens here. Okay, the ball is off. Good read on a blitz. Not a very good pass. Jones is hanging on. He's 140 pounds for dear life. And here comes Jones, the other Jones. Got him right in the ear hole with his helmet. Gary Jones. And that's a good call by the official, because rarely do you see a fella clipped who's hanging on to a ball carry.
6'2", 200. Gary Jones at the free safety. 9:43, third quarter. Aggies a lot to get excited about tonight. They lead 28-7. In quest of their seventh win of the year. Remember, they have one left next week against Bama. They could be an eight-game winning team. Nothing there at all for Darren Lewis. Roger Fritcher, who would have been a backup to Steve Llewellyn, who we talked about earlier, has played pretty well the last few weeks in a starting role because of the injury.
Going up against 67, Jerry Fontenot at 270. A little high, but gets his hands on him, stays in the hole, and gets a leg.
Steer wrestling there.
He gets a drumstick, I guess, on Thanksgiving, right?
They fake the deep pitch. Osgood rolling and throwing. Intercepted! Mark Berry! He's their best pass coverage man and has his second pickoff of the year.
You wonder why he caught it. This guy was a wide receiver in high school, senior year, 25 catches, 580 yards, and this is tremendous coverage and tremendous team defense. They pull Osgood up when he tried a naked reverse, and Berry looks like the receiver. No interference, right on the shoulder of the receiver. Look at the defense. They make Osgood throw it. He doesn't want to throw it, and Berry's sitting there, man-to-man coverage. Great play.
David McWilliams loves his break to the ball. What an example that time. Metcalf is back in. Blocking, end zone, a bump, and incomplete. Kevin Nelson guarded by Mickey Washington out in the pattern.
Well, this is the territory where Texas likes to try to cash in, keep or carry. 6'4", 210, and 6'4", 215. It worked before. What you need is man coverage. A&M would like to try to double cover him, but if they do, look down the middle. Metcalf is back in the game.
Stephen Clark is also out there. Metcalf outside, inside, and diving for another yard or two. Gary Jones finally gets him.
This is four down territory. You wonder what Metcalf could do if he had two good ankles out there. He's tough to catch. Run around a little guy like that.
Kerry Cash back in. Kevin Nelson checks out, so the big guys are in there. Cash at 6'4", Clark at 6'5".
And what they were looking there was with a draw. They were looking for him to double the outside.
Looking that way. Slanted. Touchdown!
Stephen Clark. Texas touchdowns. It's a ball game again.
This is just what we talked about. They wanted to help out on cash. There he goes, 6'4". They know they have to help, so you'll see Gary Jones, number 6. That's the safety. He's moved out of the middle. And we'll show you what happens after this.
No problem for Wayne Clemens.
You have Jones in the slot. The safety's gone. No help. Murdoch reads it perfectly. He's had a fine game. Jones makes the touchdown. We got a ball game here. Here from the side. That's Cash number 19. He's out of the picture. Murdoch knows it's double coverage. He never thinks about it. He goes to his big tight end out of the slot. Texas got a TD.
That huge contingent, 280 strong, marching and playing for the Longhorns of Texas. They hooked a couple of turnovers here tonight. One, a fumble recovery. One, an interception. And turned both into quick scores. Quarter, it was 28-0. Now it's 28-14.
It's kind of an interesting phenomenon, I think, playing as a senior on a losing team. I had that experience. It's a special moment. It's not like winning a championship. But I'll tell you, in that last game, you never quit. And you're always looking at the scoreboard. It's really not a matter of the score. It's how much time do you have left, and how are you going to go out? This kid's had a great career in Texas, never beaten Oklahoma or Texas A&M. And if you think the Longhorns are going to quit in this one, forget it.
Looked like Eric Metcalf was bloodied on that last drive, down around the chin or somewhere.
He doesn't have any reason to save it now.
Hey, there have been players stitched up and back into this baby in the past couple of years. Horns will kick it. And to Rod Harris at the two. Nothing on the near side. Good coverage by the Longhorn special teams. A flag is down on the play. Texas getting a play there from Tommy Jeter on special teams, 99.
And flipping on return, first down.
That'll push the Aggies back and put a little more pressure on an offense that's coughed it up a couple of times. Maybe now the absence of Bucky Richardson is becoming more of a factor. In the back of your screen, you saw number 10. There he is, Chris Osgood, trotting back to the field. Bucky Richardson came into the game with a bruised knee and ankle. They were nursing his knee with ice earlier. He's never returned.
Well, they remember the option is an offense that really takes precision. This is a drop-back quarterback here.
That's the fullback. Robert Wilson, after a gain of 2 or 3, stuffed by the horns.
Texas has not let A&M run what they want to run tonight. There's a flag on the play. They have stopped the running right. The thing that's killed them is the traps and the counters back. It's going to be on Texas.
Have a dead ball. Personal foul. Defense.
Oh, man. That's the second one tonight. That just kills you.
Kills Texas because field position is very important for Texas. I don't believe offensively they can put together a 15-play drive. Both of their drives have come on short drives. They don't want to give up field position. They want to hold Texas A&M deep in their territory and then get them to punt the ball around midfield. There's Hager, the last one in the pile with maybe a spear.
Osgood rolling to the line of scrimmage and maybe a yard or two. Open field effort by number 60, Britt Hager. A UT record tackle total of 187 last year. He'll be right up around that again this season. He's got range. He's not big, as Kevin mentioned earlier. The coaches love him because he'll get knocked down and still make the play.
And he's not really a middle linebacker unless you have tremendous tackle. They had them. They lost him. What he is now is a chase linebacker to sideline.
Aggies need to get a drive going here.
There's Darren Lewis, a good guy to start it with. First down for him, up the sidelines. And if he had his balance, he might have gone.
It's a counter trap again. Now, that's the play that just murdered Texas. They have a tendency to over-pursue, and then they ran into each other. You're looking from behind. Trap. It's like that counter tray the Redskins play. They pulled both the guard and the tackle. Texas over-pursued to the right. And Lewis is a step away from breaking it. They've got to stay at home a little bit, but when they do, that's going to open up the strong running game.
They had him against a linebacker one-on-one out there, and Darren Lewis having a huge night. He's now up at 1,500 yards for the year. Time for Osgood, who airs it out. Intercepted! Willie Mack Garza! Garza comes into the game tonight with a deep bruise of his lung. He doesn't start, but he gets his second interception on this play.
Bobby didn't need his lungs for this one. Willie Mack rushed for almost 3,000 yards in high school, and this is perfect defense. Sitting inside the chest of the receiver, A&M is not a passing team, and they have not been able to make it work tonight. Tremendous play by him. High school freshman, or at least a freshman out of high school last year.
7 minutes left, third quarter. Longhorns deep in their own territory, but with the ball. They've had short drives for